Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. Welcome to this Currie lecture in law and religion. It's a privilege to see so many of you here. Thank you all very much for coming. My name is John Witte. I'm the director of the law and religion program here at Emory University. The law and religion program was established at Emory in 1982. It is designed to study the religious dimensions of law, the legal dimensions of religion, and the interaction of legal and religious ideas, institutions, and methods. It draws now on the services of some 50 faculty scattered throughout the university. It pursues its work through a variety of joint degree programs, cross-listed courses, clinical internships, a visiting fellows program, two book series, ongoing research projects, and a variety of public conferences, colloquia, panel discussions, and lectures such as this one. The Currie Lecture in Law and Religion is the program's most distinguished forum. The lecture series was established in 1989 by a generous grant from the Overton and Lavona Currie Foundation here in Atlanta, and that endowment has been supplemented by generous gifts from members of the Currie family and from friends of the Currie family and of Emory Law School. And we appreciate very much the support that the Curries have given to us, and we appreciate very much the attendance in the audience of Mrs. Lavona Currie and her daughter Lucy. Past Currie lecturers have included Desmond Tutu, Martin Marty, Brian Tierney, Stephen Osmond, Charles Villavicencio, and a variety of other distinguished scholars from various parts of the world. Today we are honored with this year's Currie Lecturer in Law and Religion serving Robert Neely Bellah. Professor Bellah is the Elliott Professor of Sociology Emeritus at the University of California at Berkeley. He is a highly decorated and distinguished scholar of the sociology of religion and related fields in theology and philosophy and phenomenology of religion. He was educated at Harvard University, where he received the PhD in 1957. He began his teaching career at Harvard University, and then in 1967, he left Harvard to go to a chaired professorship at the University of California at Berkeley. There, he's distinguished himself in a variety of different positions, and he's been decorated by institutions throughout North America and Western Europe. Most recently, and most notably, he received the National Humanities Medal from the President of the United States. Some of you will know his early work in Asian religions and some of his early work on the Apache kinship systems, the subject of his first book. A few more of you will know about his work on the virtues and vices of civil religion, captured in such arresting titles as The Broken Covenant and Uncivil Religion. Still more of you will know him for his two best-selling books, Habits of the Heart and The Good Society, co-authored with four others, including Emory's own Stephen Tipton, the director of the Graduate Division of Religion. But after today, all of you will know him as a distinguished and learned commenter on institutional life in America, and particularly on the phenomenon of marriage. Please join me with robust applause in welcoming Professor Robert Bellah.
Well, thank you, John, for that very generous introduction. The topic today is marriage, sacred institution, or obsolete tyranny. Even those of us who are not prepared to think of marriage as tyranny are probably not entirely happy to think of it as an institution either. As Steve Tipton and I and the other authors of the Good Society pointed out, Americans don't really much like the idea of institutions, and this for two reasons. First, institutions come down from the past, are based on largely unexamined traditions and habits, and therefore probably don't really fit our current needs, or so we believe. And second, institutions are oppressive. At the extreme, one thinks of prisons, mental asylums. and they limit our free individual choice. Actually, this way of thinking about institutions is modern, though it has been around for a while. It is, if I may put it this way, part of the tradition of modernity. I might just say parenthetically that a while back I gave a graduate seminar at Berkeley on tradition. I got a surprisingly large number of people in the room. I opened the first session by saying, how do you feel about tradition? Universally, I was told by the students, we think it's terrible. I said, did you make that up all by yourself? Or are you part of a tradition of being against tradition? So, I'm suggesting opposition to institutions is part of the tradition of modernity. One of the earliest thinkers to express the modern criticism of inherited institutions was René Descartes in the 17th century. At the beginning of the second part of one of the founding documents of modernity, Descartes' Discourse on Method, he describes the typical European town of his day. Such a town, he says, is simply a hodgepodge, a jumble of buildings from different eras and different styles and different forms and shapes. The streets on which they are situated are often crooked, narrow, and inconvenient. How much better, says Descartes, if we could just tear the whole thing down and start over? Putting up orderly buildings on straight streets with proper right angles. In other words, Descartes' idea of an ideal town is one not one inherited from the past, but one designed anew with a rational blueprint. For Descartes, the town was a metaphor for our inherited institutions and ways of thought. In the 20th century, the Romanian dictator Ceausescu actually did pull down much of old Bucharest and erect orderly buildings in its place, with quite horrifying consequences, I think, to most observers. Anyway, in the same part of the Discourse on Method, Descartes immediately goes on to make another remarkable point. He says that he regrets that during the early years of his life, his mind was filled with opinions, stories, and baseless information, entirely unexamined by reason, and he wishes that he might have been born at the age of 20 with his mind uncluttered with so much useless material. I don't even want to think of what kind of a monster an unsocialized infant of 20 might be like. So let me start by saying that although every imaginable criticism of institutions, including the institutions of marriage and the family, has some basis, without institutions, we would not be free, we would be dead. In every aspect of our lives, we depend on the relationships that institutions make possible. This is not in the least to say that they are perfect or that they are not in need of continuous reform and improvement, only that doing away with them altogether is a monstrous idea, as attested by the actions of those in the 20th century who have tried it, Ceausescu, Pol Pot, though I think some of our rational choice theorists today are in their own way trying to do something quite similar. Aristotle is a philosopher who can help us understand why Descartes' wish to be born at the age of 20 is not a good idea either. For Aristotle, habit is an important starting point. In his ethics, virtue, his fundamental ethical term, is, he says, a habit, in Greek, a hexis, that is a formed state of character, which is in control of our emotions. We are judged, therefore, not by our emotions, but by the settled dispositions, the habits, which control our emotions. Aristotle draws from this definition a conclusion that may surprise or even offend us. He says that the young are not fit students for ethical philosophy, for they are too apt to be led by their feelings, and they have not yet developed the proper habits which would allow them to appreciate ethical reflection. Ethics, as he says, is, after all, not an exact science, and its object is not knowledge, but action. So bright young people might well study modern moral philosophy, Kant's categorical imperative, for example, or Bentham's greatest good of the greatest number, for these are purely theoretical ideas, and the young can be quite good at theory. But little good it would do them ethically, Aristotle says, if they do not already have the habits required for living an ethical life. Of course, Aristotle is quick to add, the matter is not one of chronological age, for there are some who are forever too, quote, young, unquote, to understand ethics, and some relatively young people might already have acquired virtuous habits. Still, it is worth considering the fact that Aristotle, who wrote voluminous critical treatises on just about everything, and was willing to discourse at great length on all manner of ethical problems, begins not with talk, but with habit, and says, in effect, that without habit, talk about ethics is worthless. What is shocking to us about this is that Aristotle seems to be overriding individual freedom, of course, our American central value, worse yet, the individual freedom of the young, and insisting in an utterly authoritarian manner that he will not even teach such young people about ethics until they have learned proper habits. Socrates famously questioned whether it is possible to teach virtue. And Aristotle's argument here helps us understand why. Philosophical teaching is, after all, always a matter of discursive analytical talk. Habit is clearly something else. What is that something else? To understand the difference between these two approaches, I want to turn to Mary Douglas's remarkable book, Natural Symbols, a book I have reread carefully several times in my life, each time with increasing profit. Douglas takes some interesting observations of Basil Bernstein's about London families in the mid-20th century and uses them to construct a general theory of the relation between social control and symbolic codes, a theory which, if you will bear with me, I think sheds a great deal of light on our problem of habit and of the relation of habit to institutions. Bernstein noted that there were two rather different forms of family in his sample, and that these two forms differed by class. Working class families used what he called positional control systems and restricted speech codes, and middle class families used personal control systems and elaborated speech codes. Because the word restricted is invidious in a way I think neither Bernstein nor Douglas intends, I will henceforth speak of condensed rather than restricted speech codes in contrast to elaborated ones, and will make this terminological change even when quoting them. Douglas describes the condensed speech code that is generated in the positional family. The child in this family is controlled by the continual building up of a sense of social pattern, of ascribed role categories. If he asks, why must I do this? The answer is, in terms of relative position, because I said so, hierarchy. Because you're a boy, sex role. Because children always do, age status. Because you're the oldest, seniority. As he grows, his experience flows into a grid of role categories. Right and wrong are learnt in terms of given structure. He himself is seen only in relation to that structure. That's Douglas. Douglas notes that this pattern can be found in some aristocratic as well as working class families. In any case, what I want to emphasize is that condensed code is based on the taken for grantedness of institutions. That's what it means to call it positional. There is a real social world there, and we understand each other and ourselves only in relation to it. She then describes the other form. This is Douglas again. By contrast, in the family system, which Professor Bernstein calls personal, a fixed pattern of roles is not celebrated, but rather the autonomy and unique value of the individual. When the child asks a question, the mother feels bound to answer it by as full an explanation as she knows. The curiosity of the child is used to increase his verbal control, to elucidate causal relations, to teach him to assess the consequences of his acts. Above all, his behavior is made sensitive to the personal feelings of others by inspecting his own feelings. Why can't I do it? Because your father's feeling worried. Because I've got a headache. How would you like it if you were a dog? Douglas quotes Bernstein to the effect that in the middle class family, the child is being regulated by the feelings of the regulator. Daddy will be pleased, hurt, disappointed, angry, ecstatic if you go on doing this. Control is affected through either the verbal manipulation of feelings or through the establishment of reasons which link the child to his acts, says Douglas. But let me back up a step with an example. A friend of mine was standing waiting for an elevator in his apartment building, overhearing a conversation between a mother and a small child. The child was whining about something or other most persistently, and the mother was calmly and extensively explaining why the child could not have what it wanted. The child persisted with rising, whiny tones, and the mother continued to reiterate all the reasons why not. My friend was becoming increasingly uncomfortable with this apparently interminable palaver when the mother finally said quite firmly and briefly, "Because I'm the mother and you're the child, that's why." What this mother had done was to shift rather abruptly from the elaborated code to the condensed code. This example suggests that Bernstein's two codes are not mutually exclusive, and that all of us use both of them at least some of the time. Let me use this example to link back the two codes to the idea of institutions. Condensed code is always institutionally rooted. When the mother finally invokes the mother-child relation, she is invoking a whole institutional context, a set of habits, if you will, that requires parents to care for children and children to grow up and flourish under that care. Elaborated code floats free from institutions and is rooted more in the ideas and feelings of individuals. It may usefully be used to criticize institutions, but it can never entirely abandon them, for it takes them for granted as the very basis from which criticism is possible. I would argue for the priority of institutions and the condensed code that expresses them, in part because no one ever starts with the elaborated code. All children begin with positional control and the condensed language code, because personal control and the elaborated code require skills that no newborn has. The relation between mother and child, or perhaps we should better say between parent and child, is necessarily positional, that is institutional, because highly asymmetrical. An infant needs to be held, cared for, talked, or sung to, but cannot be addressed with elaborate appeals to feelings or reasons, at least not for quite a while. In fact, interaction with an infant looks suspiciously like habit or its close relation ritual. Linguists have discovered that in all cultures, parents speak to infants in something they call motherese, a kind of simplified, highly repetitive, sing-song, partly nonsense kind of language, one that communicates feeling more than information. Each language has its own version of motherese, to be sure, but the basic characteristics seem to be quite universal. Nonverbal communication with an infant is probably even more important. Eric Erickson suggested that the greeting ceremonial between mother and child, marking the beginning of the infant's day, is the root of all subsequent ritualization. Infants become human because of habitual, non-discursive, verbal and non-verbal interaction with adults, which is, in Basil Bernstein's terms, necessarily positional in control and condensed in speech code. The function of this kind of interaction is to position children, to give them an identity relative to others, to provide them a social and institutional location. Otherwise, they would not know who they were. So far, I've been trying to insist, because of the low esteem we have these days for things like habit and ritual, not to speak of institutions, that positional control and condensed code are rather basic to our humanity and cannot really be dispensed with. So why did we develop personal control and the elaborated code in the first place? In contemporary society, Douglas links them to the division of labor, which differentially impacts working class and middle class families. It is essential, she writes, to realize that the elaborated code is a product of the division of labor. The more highly differentiated the social system, the more specialized the decision-making roles, then the more the pressure for explicit channels of communication concerning a wide range of policies and their consequences. The demands of the industrial system are pressing hard now upon education to produce more and more verbally articulate people who will be promoted to entrepreneurial roles. By inference, the condensed code will be found where these pressures are weakest, that is to say, among people whose jobs are both routine and require less verbal facility. Although Douglas finds the social basis for positional control and condensed code in some modern professions, the military, for example, most of the professions that increasingly dominate the higher echelons of our occupational world require people well-versed in personal control and elaborated speech. The symbolic analysts, as Robert Reich characterizes our top professionals, are critical by their very job description. Douglas characterizes them as follows. Here are the people who live by using elaborated speech to review and revise existing categories of thought, to challenge received ideas as their very bread and butter. They, or should I say we, this is still Douglas, after all, Mary Douglas was a great anthropologist and therefore well-versed in elaborated speech. They, or should I say we, practice a professional detachment toward any given pattern of experience. The more boldly and comprehensively they apply their minds to rethinking, the better their chances of professional success. Thus, the value of their radical habit of thought is socially confirmed and reinforced, for with the rise of professional eminence comes the geographical and social mobility that detaches them from their original community. With such validation, they are likely to raise their children in the habit of intellectual challenge and not to impose a positional control pattern. Indeed, she goes on to say, they are likely to prefer personal forms of control and to focus on feelings rather than rules in child rearing. As a result, ideas about morality and the self get detached from the social structure, she says. It is not that children raised in such a milieu lack ethical ideas. Sensitivity to the feelings of others can arouse strong ethical passions when others are observed to be suffering. The problem is that without some positional sense of institutional membership and without strong condensed symbols, ethical sensitivities may simply dissipate into good intentions without leading to sustained moral commitments. Douglas is very even-handed in her sense that we need both modes of relating. She affirms, quote, the duty of everyone to preserve their vision from the constraints of the condensed code when judging any social situation. We must recognize that the value of particular social forms can only be judged objectively by the analytic power of the elaborated code, she says. She is well aware that condensed codes in the context of institutional authority can be both authoritarian and unjust. Do it because I said so is an example of condensed code that carries the implication of some, perhaps quite unpleasant, nonverbal sanction that will follow if the recipient of the command rejects it. Except under conditions of extreme emergency, an elaborated request for reasons is certainly justified. Similarly, the condensed statement, little girls don't do that, is open to challenge with respect to the whole taken for granted definitions of gender. These are the kinds of reflection that lead us to presume that personal control and elaborated code are always preferable to the alternative. Yet Douglas warns us against precisely that conclusion. There is no person, she writes, whose life does not need to unfold in a coherent symbolic system. The less organized the way of life, the less articulated the symbolic system may be. But social responsibility is no substitute for symbolic forms and indeed depends upon them. When ritualism is openly despised, the philanthropic impulse is in danger of defeating itself. For it is an illusion to suppose that there can be organization without symbolic expression. Those who despise ritual, even at its most magical, are cherishing in the name of reason a very irrational concept of communication. That's all Mary Douglas. So where does Douglas leave us, including her? She's not asking us, as some converts to various forms of fundamentalism are, to abandon our personal and elaborated selves and jump back into the positional box. No, she is asking us with all our critical rationality to see that we need both forms of control and both codes. She writes, "In the long run, the argument of this book is that the elaborated code challenges its users to turn round on themselves and inspect their values, to reject some of them, and to resolve to cherish positional forms of control and communication wherever these are available. No one would deliberately choose the elaborated code in the personal control system who is aware of the seeds of alienation it contains." But the question remains, in what sense can we, products of personal families and modern educational and occupational systems, deliberately choose, in her words, aspects of positional control and condensed code? I will argue that some dialectic, some complementarity, must be sought, because giving up either alternative would exact too high a price. I think we know the price of going back into the box of some kind of closed traditionalism. Can we explore further the implications of Douglass's warning about trying to live in the elaborated code alone? If we see that trying to live in the elaborated code alone would mean that we would have to make up our lives as we go along, that we could take nothing for granted because we would have no institutional context to tell us where we are, we can begin to see that it is not only undesirable, it is impossible. Douglass's dichotomy may be too stark, for even the citadel of critical reason, the modern university, is an institution with the habits and rituals that institutions always entail. What am I doing right now? Giving a lecture. That's a ritual. One you are so habituated to that you hardly recognize it as a ritual, even though it is a fairly complex one. Last night at dinner, I mentioned that Pierre Bourdieu, who just passed away this week in accepting an appointment at the Collège de France, the most elite academic institution in France, with all his populism and peasant background, was very uneasy about accepting it at all. And his inaugural lecture, in which he finally did end up accepting it, thank you very much, was about the lecture. And it was a lecture against the lecture. It was a deconstruction of the lecture as a form of power. Bourdieu is a smart guy. Anyway, the point I'm trying to make is, if you think you just came in here to hear some guy talking, you don't realize that what's happening in this room now has centuries of taken-for-granted understandings behind it. And education, I mean, I'm not saying a lecture is the only form. We know many other forms, but seminars are also ritual forms and couldn't exist if they weren't. But you might say, aren't some institutions in modern society based entirely on elaborated codes? Aren't they purely rational? Economic institutions, for example. Yet in recent years, economists have been rediscovering what was once called institutional economics. The economist Jeffrey Hodgson suggests why institutions are essential in the economy, as anywhere else in our social life. He writes, "In a world of uncertainty, institutions play a functional role in providing a basis for decision-making, expectation, and belief. Without these, quote, rigidities, unquote, without social routine and habit," he uses the word habit to reproduce them, "and without institutionally conditioned conceptual frameworks, an uncertain world would present a chaos of sense data in which it would be impossible for the agent to make sensible decisions and to act." Even in the heart of rational choice economics, not that Hodgson is a rational choice theorist, but nonetheless, that's where rational choice, if it applies anywhere, applies, you still have to have the taken-for-grantedness of institutions, or you have chaos. But in economic life, institutions do more than provide a basis for decision-making. One of the most fundamental institutions in the economic realm is contract. Contract provides the trust, the faith, if you will, that the other party will not violate promises just because it is in his interest to do so, and that there is legal recourse if he does. A capitalist economy is not based on rational choice alone, but on widely accepted institutions. Ultimately, I would argue, on trust. As Durkheim said, contract finally depends on non-contractual understandings that lie behind it and guarantee it. We saw what happened in Russia when the shock therapy of privatization recommended by American economists produced mafia-style manipulation, not rational capitalism, because the institutional basis for a modern economy did not exist. Above all, no trust. No trust, no rational capitalism. Even though, which is not to say the U.S. is perfect, as we know from picking up the daily paper, that you cannot trust necessarily the balance sheets that you are supposed to be able to trust. Even though I have argued institutions are indispensable in every sphere of our lives, there is a truth not obvious to moderns, especially modern Americans. We have seen Mary Douglas noting that in the modern occupational system, especially its upper echelons, where professional expertise and skills of verbal criticism are highly rewarded, institutional loyalties are not only not valued, often they are hardly understood. Since Douglas wrote, the trends she noted have become ever more pervasive. A good recent discussion of these trends is Robert Wethnow's book, Loose Connections, whose very title exposes the problem. In America, and increasingly in other developed nations, people aren't plugged in very tightly to groups and associations. They may volunteer a few hours a week for a while, but they won't join an organization that will expect their loyalty and commitment for the long haul, or at least they are much more reluctant to than once they were. Even commitment to marriage and family, leave aside job and vocation, are much more fragile, much more dependent on individual mood than they used to be. Loose connections is a powerful metaphor, but Wethnow puts this metaphor of loose connections together with another metaphor that partly explains it. Porous institutions. Porous institutions are ones that don't hold individuals very securely. Porous institutions are ones that leak. In a world of porous institutions, it is hard to have any connections that are not loose. One thinks of the family, whereas in 1960, one in four marriages would fail, today one in two will. And a lot of consequences follow from that. The fastest growing category of households is those with one member, which now amount to 25% of all households. Families, as we know, do not necessarily consist of two parents and their children. Husbands and wives drift in and out, often bringing children from a former marriage with them, resulting in what are called blended families. However successfully families are coping with these conditions, and I have no doubt that many families are very successful, there is always the uncertainty. Will this marriage last? Will my parents divorce? We have heard Mary Douglas urging us to, quote, cherish, unquote, the condensed code and the institutions that make it intelligible wherever they are available. But how can we moderns, immersed as we are in the critical, elaborated code, understand such an injunction? Let me try to answer the question by turning to the contemporary philosopher Alasdair MacIntyre. In his recent book, Dependent Rational Animals, MacIntyre points out that our philosophical tradition, going all the way back to Aristotle, assumes the standpoint of an independent, autonomous, adult male. But the truth of our condition is that we come into the world dependent, we end our days dependent, and are often, more often than we like to admit, dependent all the days of our lives. But dependency is by definition positional. Without institutions, dependency would be a disaster. We have to define ourselves in relation to others because we need them. The elaborated code requires that we see ourselves or pretend to as entirely apart from the world, totally free to pursue our own interests and express our own feelings. What I'm trying to say is that for us to feel at home in the condensed code and appreciate the institutions on which we depend, we would have to give up the illusion of absolute autonomy and recognize that we are related to, even dependent on, others. We are in a world. none of us has the view from nowhere, from outer space. And to imagine so is to imagine that we are God, which is the ultimate category mistake. Let me turn finally to marriage in order to show that, though it can be, as in the case of the Taliban, an obsolete tyranny, it can still, properly understood, be affirmed as a sacred institution. In the traditional view of marriage, husband and wife become one flesh. Indeed, Genesis 2, verse 24 says, "Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh." And this is reiterated in the New Testament, both in the words of Jesus and of Paul. That is positional control and condensed code with a vengeance, "they shall be one flesh." And not surprisingly, moderns find it very hard to take. I have been to weddings in Berkeley where husband and wife becoming one flesh has been strongly and explicitly disavowed. In one such ceremony, the man and woman were sent into two different rooms for a moment to symbolize that they are separate people and will continue to be separate after the marriage. And of course, there is a good reason. When people said that man and wife become one flesh, whose flesh did they have in mind? Although actually in the passage in Genesis, the man cleaves to his wife, so we might imagine that it is her flesh that he becomes. But anyway, fair enough. If positional control and condensed code have been used to affirm gender inequality, and who can deny that they have, why not jettison the whole idea of one flesh? Because gender inequality is not all that that ancient symbolism affirms, I would argue. And because we, children of criticism, can reaffirm the institution of marriage critically, disavowing the inequality while affirming the solidarity. The price of giving up the symbolism of one flesh altogether is high. If we do that, we are tempted to believe that leaving a marriage is no different from entering one. We can speak of a starter marriage or a marriage with term limits, humorously, of course, but there's a lot of truth in humor. But upon reflection, if we really want to get married, and the great majority of Americans still do, even many gays who aren't allowed to, then we may not really like the implications of the idea of marriage as an easily broken contract. And here, John Whitty's book, towards the end, when he deals with some of contemporary tendencies in marriage, suggests that it's precisely becoming an easily broken contract. It was Hegel, however, who said, "Marriage is not a contractual relationship. On the contrary, though marriage begins in contract, it is precisely a contract to transcend the standpoint of contract." In other words, Hegel is saying marriage is a contract to enter a non-contractual relationship. I'm not saying, and neither was Hegel, that divorce is never justified, but that it is a last resort, because marriage is a solidarity so central, not only to the couple, but to their children and everyone around them, that it is not likely to be tossed aside. As Mary Douglas has pointed out, strong social solidarity is almost always symbolized by body images. That husband and wife become one flesh is not too strong an image, I believe, for what marriage really is. My insistence on institutions and the condensed code does not at all mean that I oppose reform. As Douglas has argued, inherited institutions need constantly to be monitored with the elaborated code, not so that they can be abandoned, but so that they can be improved. Just because I believe so strongly in marriage, I think today it requires a major reform. It should be extended to include same-sex couples. Why stable, well-institutionalized relations between gay people should threaten marriage more than transient and unstable relations between them is something I've never been able to understand. The argument against gay marriage by the people that I respect most, such as Nicholas Boyle and Stanley Hauerwas, namely that marriage is a productive relationship because it can give rise to children, whereas a gay relationship could only be based on consumption, that is, it is a form of recreation, seems to me entirely unconvincing. Gay couples often do want children, by artificial insemination if they are women, by adoption if they are men. Heterosexual couples often choose not to have children at all. As in almost every sphere today, nothing can be taken for granted in marriage, straight or, if it were possible, gay. The idea that marriage entails the nurturance of children, which I do believe is essential, an essential marker of marriage, is something which in our world cannot be imposed, but of which people must be persuaded. But there's another basis of marriage that I believe has equal dignity with the fact that married couples can have children. The kind of love and support in a committed relationship that is hard to find anywhere else. The book of Ecclesiastes in its wonderful prose makes my case, even when the reference is not explicitly to marriage. It is better, says Ecclesiastes, that you should be together than one, for they have the advantage of their society. If one fall, he shall be supported by the other. Woe to him that is alone, for when he falleth, he hath none to lift him up. Again, if two lie together, they are warm. But how can one be warm alone? Anyone in a long marriage, when the children have left home years ago, knows that the advantage of society, as Ecclesiastes puts it, is at the heart of marriage, important though children and grandchildren, I'm at that point in my life, are. Why should we want to deprive same-sex couples of that consolation? I'm not against singleness. I think people who have a calling for singleness, for whom it is a decided choice, that needs to be respected. I don't understand why it has to be imposed. When I was asked to give this talk, I was given a very full plate. I was told that your theme is sex, marriage, and the family in the context of law and religion. Out of this mix, I have chosen to focus on marriage. I haven't said anything about sex, so if you came expecting that, you're disappointed. I have chosen to focus on marriage and to show what kind of thing marriage is by considering it as an institution. And given the bad reputation of institutions in our society, I've spent most of my time trying to explain what institutions are and how they relate to other forms of action in our society and how they are indispensable. But it is just in thinking of marriage as an institution that I hope briefly to clarify its relation to law and religion. At first glance, one might think that law is a pure example of elaborated code and that its purpose is to enhance the efficiency of transactions, not to undergird institutions. This is, of course, the teaching of Judge Richard Posner and the very influential Law and Economics School, which is an outgrowth of the Chicago School of Economics. But is law really like Ceausescu's Bucharest? Which sometimes Posner seems to be sounding like. Or is it like the European towns that Descartes found so problematic? One learns a great deal of critical thinking in law school and must indeed become adept in the elaborated code. But doesn't one also have to learn a lot of condensed code, language that lawyers take for granted but lay people scarcely understand? And can we simply dismiss that condensed code as professional mystification? Or is it an abbreviated way of referring to centuries-long experience with the reality of legal adjudication? The English law professors who most recently translated Justinian's Institutes give us pause when they write in their introduction, "One question to be considered, not of course decisive, but not unimportant either, is how deeply rooted our current ways of thinking and teaching actually are. If it were true in the law schools that," and here they quote a recent author, quote, "our basic conceptual apparatus, the fundamental characterizations and divisions which we impose on the phenomena with which we deal, do not reflect the values of our own times, but those of the last century," unquote. If that were true, we might well be disposed to view them as contingent and probably mistaken. But they go on to say, however, when the truth is that those same categories of legal thought have been surviving critical onslaughts in different jurisdictions and under different political systems since the time of Justinian in the 6th century and Gaius in the 2nd, we are bound to approach the issue of radical reform at least with some self-doubt. If we look at the opening of Justinian's institutes, which the translators argue has been of incalculable influence on all Western legal systems, not only continental ones, but common law systems as well, we may discern something else that is largely dropped from modern consciousness, namely that law in all traditional societies has been grounded in religion. The institutes opens with the words, In nomine Domini nostri Jesu Christi. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And the first paragraph begins in Burks and McLeod's translation, justice is an unswerving and perpetual determination to acknowledge all men's rights. Learning in the law entails knowledge of God and man and mastery of the difference between justice and injustice. Why marriage and family as institutions and the law in which they are grounded should partake of the sacred, should have something religious about them, is largely unintelligible on the basis of contemporary assumptions and requires an effort of interpretation to understand. According to the presuppositions of modern philosophy and modern common sense, a person is an autonomous entity bounded by the surface of his or her body and relates to others as one sovereign state relates to another. Which implies, if we know our Hobbes, that they are in a perpetual state of war with one another, absent temporary forms of truce. I think we are beginning to see, with the help of some modern philosophers and social scientists, as well as the testimony of all the great traditions, that this conception of personhood is either completely wrong or seriously one-sided. Ourselves are not atomistic, but relational. We would not even have a self if it were not for our relations to other human beings, to the natural world, and to the reality that underlies the world. Law and religion are two of the most fundamental expressions of that relatedness. This does not mean that they cannot be challenged or that they are not in constant need of reform. It does mean that the idea of abandoning them altogether or the institutions they sustain is a recipe for disaster, or imagining that we can replace them entirely with rational market decisions. With respect to many spheres of life, the status of women is an important example. We know that uncritical and habitual affirmation of the status quo has often legitimated injustice or worse. Criticism and the elaborated code that makes it possible are absolutely necessary if we are to overcome ancient and modern evils. But criticism has to be criticism of something. Criticism alone cannot provide a basis for life. Rather, criticism, like appetite in Shakespeare, can become an universal wolf that in the end eats up itself. In 2002, it would be well to realize that our critical elaborated code and our personal freedom, good as they are in themselves, cannot survive without institutions and the beliefs and practices that undergird them. In short, if we think seriously about marriage as an institution, we will not want to abandon it, but reform and renew it as one of the foundations of a good form of life. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Bellah. It's my privilege now to call upon my friend and colleague, Don Browning, to offer a brief response before we move to a conversation with you. Professor Browning is the Alexander Campbell Professor of Social Sciences and Religious Thought at the University of Chicago. He is also the Robert W. Woodruff Visiting Professor of Interdisciplinary Religious Studies at Emory University. has been working with us this year in our new Center for the Interdisciplinary Study of Religion on the project Sex, Marriage, and Family, which has supported this lecture as well. Professor Browning has made his career initially in psychology of religion and phenomenology of religion. He's moved in recent decades to issues of theological ethics, and in the last decade, he has taken on the interdisciplinary study of the family. He has been director of the Religion, Culture, and Family Project at the University of Chicago for the last 11 years. That has been a landmark project which has set forth at least 12 new volumes, hundreds of new articles, a major PBS video that's going to be showing on Valentine's Day this year at 10 p.m. Eastern Time on marriage and family. He has written a number of books and articles in the field of family studies, the most important for our purposes, From Culture Wars to Common Ground, co-authored with several other colleagues, which follows in something of the methodological wake of Habits of the Heart and the Good Society. Professor Browning, please.
Responses to lectures by distinguished guests should be brief, since I am myself a guest of Emory University. I should be even briefer. It is also wise, rhetorically, to begin one's remarks with positive responses before raising more difficult issues. In this case, my positive list is far longer than my negative list. This may enable me to be both rhetorically and possibly even politically correct. I have not made use of the riches of Mary Douglas as fully as has Robert Bellah, but beginning with the importance of tradition for understanding that one finds in the hermeneutic philosophy of Hans-Georg Gadamer and the movements of criticism and distanciation as sub-moments within understanding found in the thought of Paul Ricoeur, I have sensibilities very similar to those of Robert Bellah. In fact, it was Bellah and his colleagues in Habits of the Heart that first make me take seriously the claims of hermeneutic social science, the role of tradition in social science understanding, and the subordinate role of explanation, what Bellah is now calling elaborated speech. But there is a new accent in today's lecture. The dialectic of understanding and explanation applied to tradition and habits of the heart is now applied to ritual. I agree with the importance of this move. The classics of a tradition may be found even more in its rituals than in its texts. I agree that in understanding rituals, there's a dialectical relation between symbolically powerful condensed codes and the elaborated language of interpretation and explanation. I agree that for civilized and critical societies, we need both condensed codes and elaborated speech. I agree that it is in the moment of elaborated speech that both apologetic defense and critique emerge. I take seriously the point that condensed codes precede elaborated speech, and without being nurtured by the condensed codes of classical rituals, elaborated speech becomes disoriented and empty. I am sympathetic with the claim that institutions, in their solidity and experience givenness, have tacit and often overt ritual dimensions to them. And I agree that the institution of marriage is an excellent example of this dialectic and is one worth being honored as a ritual, as well as criticized and reconstructed by elaborate speech. I told you my list of agreements was going to be relatively long. But the condensed codes of ritual are indeed complex. And when we start analyzing them, we learn just how complex they are. Furthermore, marriage as an institution does not come to us in our kind of society any longer only as ritual. Marriage as an institution has several different dimensions or levels as we experience it today. First, there are generally legal codes. This is complex then. For centuries, the marital rituals of Christianity, to take an example, have interacted with elaborated legal and cultural codes from a variety of cultures. Christian marriage as ritual has been combined with the elaborated codes of Jewish, Greek, Roman, German, canon law, Reformation, and Enlightenment legal traditions, developing a kind of plastic relationship to some extent between the symbolic ritual and mythic dimensions and the codes themselves. Second, there is the dimension of called the goods of marriage. Marriage as an institution has been seen as containing a variety of goods that thoughtful people from Aristotle to Musonius Rufus, from Augustine to Aquinas to Maimonides and Algazea, were able to elaborate with considerable precision centuries ago. The articulation of these goods is sometimes found in the rituals themselves, but often found more fully in the elaborated theological and legal texts that give accounts of marriage. Third, the condensed codes of ritual often contain abstract principles of obligation about mutual commitment of both husband and wife, for instance, in sickness and health, and richness and poorness. And finally, the condensed codes of ritual contain narratives, often about the nature of God's action in the world, that marriage itself is thought to model. But there may be no straight causal line between the sacred narrative of a ritual, and especially a marital ritual, and other dimensions of marriage as an institution. Many of the Roman and Germanic marriage codes upon which the Christian marriage narrative was grafted in Catholic canon law did not directly flow from Christian narrative. The concrete codes and habits that gain sacred valence in the marriage ritual are highly complex, often have a variety of sources, and are difficult to trace in their interaction. Bellah's elaborated analysis of the ritual of marriage settles mainly on the second dimension listed above, the dimension of goods. Bellah likes the ritual of marriage because it provides sacred solidarity for some classic goods that he highly values. He agrees with the direction of much of modern American family law, that the committed, affectional relationship between two individuals is the highest good, and the good that both the condensed code of ritual and the elaborated code of law should respectively bless and legitimate. In this, he also agrees with much of contemporary religious thought, not the least of which is the writings of Pope John Paul II. The Pope now tends to place the unitive or affectional goods of marriage as at least co-equal, if not above, the procreative goods. Although in contrast to Bellah, he never disconnects procreative goods from the institution of marriage qua institution. Bellah values the good of procreation, but believes that neither law can force it nor ritual make it any longer central. For this reason, he contemplates a major reform of marriage so that gay and lesbian couples can benefit from the solidarity of the ritual blessing. To develop a more commanding argument for this intriguing proposal, however, Bellah may need to make a more complex analysis of both the condensed codes and the elaborated law governing marriage in our society. Now, being a man of weak mind and will, I must confess that I have never come to a final conclusion on this important issue. However, in my recent book titled Reweaving the Social Tapestry Toward a Public Philosophy and Policy for Families, I did summarize the arguments for and against this critical turn in the definition of marriage. Bellah's elaborated speech touches on some of these arguments, but not all. Here are most of the main arguments, as I understand them, for homosexual marriage. First, many homosexual couples are in love with each other in ways that mirror current grounds for marriage among heterosexuals. This love gets to the core of their identities as human beings. Therefore, it is unjust to deny them the institution of marriage. Part of Bellah's elaborated argument is close to this position. Second, homosexual relations between couples in love need protections, insurance, rights, etc. And formal marriage affords these protections. Third, religio-cultural and associated legal traditions that have forbidden homosexual marriage are more complicated than they appear at first glance and may not necessarily oppose such unions when carefully interpreted. And fourth, marriage has a stabilizing effect on loving relations. Homosexual relations need the settled influence of the formal institution of marriage. And this last argument, I take it, is close to the core of Bellah's belief in the solidifying effects of public ritual. But there are four very parallel arguments against extending marriage to gays and lesbians, some of which Bellah's elaborated codes address, some of which they did not. First, some say that to extend marital privileges and responsibilities to homosexual couples is inherently unjust. It discriminates against non-erotic friendships and groups sharing economies of scale who might also want the privileges and protections often granted the married. But to extend these privileges and protections, so goes the argument, so broadly throughout society is unworkable and finally renders marriage meaningless. Second, the unique protections of marriage as institution, largely associated with it, childbearing and child-rearing aspects and goods. Although the affectional dimensions of marriage are becoming more prominent, the marital institution qua institution must not be reduced to its affectional goods alone, but should be centrally connected, continue to be connected with the goods of children and child care. Third, some of the axial, in fact, none of the axial religions have advocated homosexual marriage as such. To make it legal will further alienate our elaborated legal codes from the classic religio-cultural traditions and rituals. Fourth, absent the interest of what marital stability means for children, there is little state interest in the stability of homosexual relations and little evidence that the institution of marriage as such will have stabilizing effects. Well, this list is not exhaustive, but it illustrates, I think, the complexity of the relationship between condensed codes and elaborated speech, particularly in view of the fact that the relation of customary rituals of marriage and elaborated legal codes of society, especially in the West, have often been not only complex, but sometimes contingent and unpredictable. Condensed codes do not necessarily give rise to exactly the same set of elaborated codes. To keep condensed codes of ritual and elaborated speech about marriage in some kind of reciprocal relation is a value that I think Bellah would value, but indeed is a value that may be increasingly more challenging for us to accomplish as we address the variety of issues facing marriage today. Thank you.
I think the gauntlet has been dropped, and I think Professor Bellah needs an opportunity to respond to that response, and then we will open the floor. There are a few people that will be weaving out for their classes, and we take notice of your departure, and we thank you very much for coming. Professor Bellah, a few minutes' response, and then a couple of questions from the floor.
Well, I'm kind of charmed that Don picked up my challenge, which was a sort of in-your-face position about gay marriage, which was put in there in part to show you that I'm not a hopeless reactionary. But he raises some serious points. For one thing, I think he overlooked the fact that I did argue for procreation or for child care as part of homosexual marriage. I'm amused at the fact that one of the great Old Testament scholars, Jacob Milgram, a rabbinical scholar who's spent his whole life studying Leviticus, if you can imagine a wonderful life spent studying Leviticus, advocates gay marriage for Jews because he says, Jews are disappearing. We need the gays to get married and adopt children and raise them as Jews. So he's arguing for gay marriage on procreational, in the largest sense, terms. And secondly, I do not advocate gay marriage on the basis of love, at least as that is understood in contemporary America, because I'm afraid that the notion of marriage is based on love in contemporary America is one of the greatest enemies of marriage we have. I don't love you anymore. I don't know when I stopped loving you. There's a very strange notion of what love is. If you've experienced a long marriage, as I have, you know the meanings of love are very, very infinite and changing, and they are not what passes for love in American culture today. Affection, association, a profound commitment, yes, it has an element of love, but not romantic love as understood today is not the basis for any kind of marriage, heterosexual or homosexual, in my view. However, I hope that the discussion will not focus entirely on this issue, though perhaps it's my fault for raising an inflammatory issue to leaven what I thought might otherwise appear to be a very conservative talk. But I'm quite prepared to defend my position if that's what you want to talk about, but there are other things in the talk.
Let me just add, I think that's a really important observation to make. I take it that was an illustration, a good one and a telling illustration, but the relationship between condensed codes and elaborated speech, I take it is the core of it and very, very worth talking about. All that I agree
with.
Yes,
that's true.
May I invite questions from the floor? May I warn you against temptations to pursue the elaborated code? May I remind you that brevity is the soul of wit and the insistence of witty. We have about 10 minutes for questions. And if you have a few pithy questions you would like to put to either speaker or to both speakers for commentary, I invite them now. Please signal by raising your hand and I'll recognize you from the lectern. Madam.
Question for Dr. Bellah. Correct me if I'm wrong, but your comments made me think that you think the group of relationships that we call blended families are sort of an individualistic free-for-all outside of the institution of marriage. I would see those as actually new institutions that have their own forms and rules. And actually, as part of this reform movement about the marriage institution that you and I both seem to
so my question is, I'm wondering why you don't see blended families as part of the reform of the institution of marriage. Oh, I do. If I sounded too negative about it, I'm sorry. It's part of the reality with which we live, and it's one of our major tasks to make such blended families work. I may tell you that I have a daughter who divorced after having one child and remarried and has another child. And I love my daughter and I love her first husband and I wish she hadn't gotten divorced from her first husband. I can't help it, I do. But I love her second husband too and I love both the children. But I'm telling you, it's hard. It's hard. It's hard for the father of one child to be fully sympathetic with a child whose father is not in that family right now. He works at it, and I think he does on the whole, a very good job. But I know that divorce is part of our life and that it's foolish to rail against it. But I do think, I think if people worked a little harder, we might not have quite as much divorce. And mainly I think what I try to suggest that comes out of the work of Judith Wallerstein, and I've seen this too in students. We had a graduate student who did a book, Carla Hackstaff, that's actually been published now on what she calls the divorce culture. students would come into her class, and it was clear what they wanted to talk about was their own pain, the pain of their own parents' divorce. I'm just suggesting that there's a lot of evidence that children suffer. I know that bad marriages are hard on children. I know all that. I just think if we take divorce as the norm, as perfectly expectable and no problem, that it is not as healthy as if we see, yes, there are situations where marriages are impossible, and yes, we have to have the option of divorce. But it's not, as the divorce culture says, a gateway to some wonderful new thing. It's a last resort, and it's an admission of failure. And it's very hard on everyone. It's hard not just on the couple, and not even just on their children. It's hard on their parents. It's as Judith Wallerstein says, it's the destruction of a small civilization. So I'm perfectly aware that this is a reality. I live with it. I live with it all the time. And I'm very supportive of it. And I thank God my first son-in-law is a very good father and sees his son every week, and I love him, and everybody is trying to make the best of it they can. But to me, it's not the first choice, and if we ever get in a situation where we think it's just as good, then I think we're in trouble. And I think we are there now.
Further questions from the floor, please. Madam.
Bob, you answered that. I just want to make sure people understood I was just giving articulation to four standard statements and against, statements, and not necessarily that was my own position. But you go ahead.
Well, I'm not sure I have any answer more than what I already said. I mean, I certainly think that children, as I've said already, are an important part of marriage, and if gay marriage were possible, I think that more gay couples would be in the position of nurturing children. But it, as you say, it's not the only thing, and neither in law nor in the tradition has it ever been the only thing. And John points out, and John Paul II has emphasized that it's not the only thing, though it is one of the indispensable things. So I don't know. I don't really have a problem with what you're saying. It seems to me right.
Sir. Or they are in a temporary
Well, I think your observation is right, and certainly in the society in which we live, there to be invidious towards single people would be very, very unfortunate. And my point was that if singleness is chosen, or if one feels called religiously to the single life, that has to be deeply respected. My only point was that singleness should not be imposed on people who would prefer not to choose it. Now, this is an issue that's, I mean, I'm very close to the Catholic Church. I've worked very closely in the Graduate Theological Union with the several Catholic schools there. I know a lot of Catholic priests. The calling, the vocation of singleness is tough. It's hard. And there's very little today in the larger culture that supports it, even for priests. It makes the priesthood difficult. And I think there will always be a place for those called religiously to the single life. Whether the parish priesthood should always be celibate is another question. But I think it's an open question, at least for some people, even certainly many people within the Catholic Church. So, yeah, I mean, there's two sides of this. One you're emphasizing is that perhaps we overlook the dignity of people who are single, not because they're waiting to get married, but because that's what they want to be, and we shouldn't. On the other hand, we shouldn't impose singleness on people who aren't really, in the end, called for it. And maybe we could adjust things in that direction, too.
Well, I think that's an interesting observation. If I understand it, you're raising the possibility that you can have simultaneously a strong vocation of singleness and a strong marriage culture. And I think that that's absolutely the case. And whatever you want to say about Catholic perspectives on marriage or even Catholic perspectives on celibacy, they do illustrate that you can carry these two things and put them together. You can have a strong theology of celibacy or singleness. You may say they haven't got a strong theology of singleness outside of celibacy, but at least it shows you that you can have a strong theology that pertains to the single life in some respects, and it's a strong pro-marriage culture at the same time. It's also the case that probably Protestants haven't worked it out as well. I would recommend that you visit some black churches. I've visited some and studied some, and some black churches have very, very powerful and productive theologies of singleness at the same time that they're working very hard to counteract some of the forces that are being so difficult on black families. So there are some things to learn from some black churches.
One final question, sir. Put your question, and I'll give the two speakers an opportunity to respond to your question and to make any final comments, and then we'll adjourn. Please.
Dr. Bellah, you talked about the increasing porosity of contemporary institutions. Can you see given that state of affairs that it might be prudent not to jump into an institution with the same level of enthusiasm?
Right. Oh, you are so right. And actually, in the experience of this student of mine who worked on divorce culture and who gave courses for undergraduates at Berkeley on divorce culture, many children of divorce have very grave hesitations about getting married themselves and great anxiety that they can't really trust the other person, and that the relationship will be transient. And as I say, that in spite of the fact that we've accepted transience in marriage, there's a deep hunger for a marriage that will last until death do us part. And so you're absolutely right. I mean, if we don't strengthen the it's a circle. A sense of institutional strength encourages people to enter it. A sense of institutional weakness makes people hesitate to enter it. So as usual, the reform of the institution and the change of personal motivation are a circle. It isn't one or the other. The chicken or the egg doesn't come first. They have to go together. I guess I think it's worth pointing out that we live in a society, since we're the most powerful and the richest society in the world, that we're now prepared to exercise our military power anywhere on earth that we feel like at any moment without asking leave from anybody, we think we are the norm. We think everybody else is either like us or ought to be. The fact of the matter is, and every comparative study I know shows it, we are the weirdest society on earth. We are off the charts on all these measures of social solidarity. The other advanced societies in Europe, in Japan, none of them are like us. They may be moving in our direction, but much more slowly. And they haven't gone nearly as far as we have. So institutions are less porous and connections are less weak in most of the advanced world. I'm not talking about really poor societies where I don't think people want them to be weak, but often for sheer circumstances make it hard to maintain coherent institutions. But if most of the advanced world feels social solidarity is considerably more important than we do and believes in institutions and believes in regulation, for instance, and not deregulation of everything from marriage on, maybe we might realize we've gone too far and that the costs of our move in the direction of deinstitutionalization are too great and join most of the rest of the world rather than thinking that the direction we've gone in for quite a while is inevitable and everybody else has to become like us.
I want to thank our two distinguished speakers, Professors Bellah and Browning, for vindicating their reputations as world-class speakers and world-class commentators. A couple of additional words of thanks, if I may. I want to thank Lavona Currie for her generous benefaction and for her generous presence here. Greet Overton for us and greet the members of your family, and Lucy as well, we appreciate your being here. I want to thank Steve Tipton, the director of the Graduate Division of Religion, who masterminded the visit of this great man from Berkeley and who has orchestrated a number of events for us under the aegis of the Law and Religion Program and the Center for the Interdisciplinary Study of Religion. I want to thank Corky and Scott, our video people, for being here again and videoing these events. I want to thank Amy Wheeler and Lori Langland, Eliza Ellison and Anita Mann, and Janice Wiggins, the Dream Team staff of the Center for the Interdisciplinary Study of Religion, for putting on all the logistics for this event. Thank you to all, and please join me in thanking them. We stand adjourned.
Always enjoyed. I think this is the third time I've had the honor of responding to you. I did it at the AR when Habits came.
Right,
I
right.
I did it at your 7th.